A woman with a remote walks away from two women working on a laptop.
Well, thanks to Kat for really setting this up for all of us for the whole day and just to be thinking inclusively, thinking of all the different characteristics a person might have when we're designing something, whether designing anything. So I'm going to pick up on that inspiration to get down to, well, what does a framework look like? How do you make this happen in an intentional way? And so we're talking about universal design, a framework for inclusion. So I'm Sheryl Burgstahler. I work at the University of Washington in the Access Technology Center, but also our Do It program, Disabilities, Opportunities, Internetworking, and Technology. We have a reference book. I'm the editor of the book, but my claim to fame is I have 40 different people from around the country who are experts on universal design and various applications who are authoring the chapters of that book. There is also an email discussion list that goes along with it. The book is and the discussion list are focused on universal design, specifically in higher education. And so if you want to join this online learning community of about 150 people all around the world that are talking about universal design, particularly in higher education, you might want to join that list. And to join it, you send email to doit@uw.edu. And just say you want to join the UDHE community, and you will be a member. It's not a high-traffic book, so you don't have to worry about having tons of email in your inbox from this, but you'll hear about conferences and new books that are coming out and things like that from all over the world. So we have a number of handouts within our Do It Center, I provided you with one, which is a little blue-purplish one on the application of universal design in education. There are some companion pieces that go with it. Accessible web design, accessible distance learning, and a bunch of other handouts that are similar to this. And if you're interested in having more printed copies of these other publications, it's over, I think they're over on a table nearby, right by the coffee, actually. Coffee and tea there on the right-hand side of that table. And so you might want to pick up some of those. Or you can look on our website, uw.edu/DOIT, and they're all up there. Not only they're there in a PDF form, the nice pretty form, but also in an accessible form, HTML and a different version actually that you can access that way as well, which we're going to talk a little bit about accessible technology here today. So again, I work at the UW at the Access Technology Center, which has been in effect since 1984. I actually founded it. I was actually kind of shocked that the university wanted to hire me when I was only 13 years old, but you know, I thought, well, I'll, when you're in middle school, you just get a kick out of these things. I thought, yeah, I'll do that. It was the year that, can anybody tell me what year that was? I mean, in terms of IT, I worked for the IT organization, and it was one thing that actually drew me here at the university. What happened in 1984? The year of one of these computers. You guys are just too young. The Macintosh. Yeah, and that was a deal changer for me as far as technology. My background's in math and computer science, but I thought this computer is going to change the world in computing. I think it has. But the University of Washington was part of the Apple University Consortium. And so I was drawn here. So we got to meet with Steve Jobs every year, and we were treated along with these other 15 schools where they were trying to get Macintosh computers accepted by post-secondary education. We were happy to engage in that activity. But I had some experience. I had a significant personal experience with disability in my family and also some professional experiences. And before I came here, I was very interested in inclusion and accessible design, particularly as it pertains to technology. Because I saw the old Apple II computer and others before that as being wonderful tools for people with disabilities if we could just make sure that they could get access to them. So I brought that interest with me in funding the microcomputer support group, made sure that we dealt with accessible technology as well as other issues regarding technology. But in 1992, I decided that I wanted to focus more on accessible technology for people with disabilities and the impact that technology can have on their lives. And so I looked around campus, and I'd been here a few years, and it's easy to see when you look around campus, people that are really passionate about their work often get their own money. So I set about teaching myself or learning from other people, and how can I get my own money to do the stuff I want to do? I didn't want to leave my job. I was very happy in UWIT. But anyway, so I started grant writing, and as my boss called it, dabbling in grant writing, that he was supportive of. Well, all that dabbling has has resulted in over $50 million that support our Do It efforts, mainly from the National Science Foundation, the U.S. Department of Education, Microsoft, other companies, anyone, State of Washington, anyone who will give us money to make life better for people with disabilities using technology as an empowering tool, and helping facilitate leadership opportunities for people with disabilities to make that happen. As I tell students at our program, we named it Do It because we want you to go out and do it, and we're facilitating that, hopefully, opening doors for you. So we also even have a Do It in Japan. They have a center over there that started in 2007, and we have some efforts in Malaysia and Singapore, South Korea, so over in Asian countries. And the Department of Education funded us to start the Universal Design in Education Center, online center, in 1999. So we've done a lot of work in this area and explored different ways to look at universal design. So what does it mean? I think we know better after Kat's great talk on what it means to be an inclusive environment. So what does it mean, like say here at the university? Well, it means everyone who meets the requirements with or without accommodations is allowed in, inside that circle. And so here we need to make sure that this facility is accessible to someone who has a disability, but other characteristics that might in some other environments make them not accessible. Then it's also important to make everybody feel welcome once they get in this room and be part of the group. And then we engage everyone. When we talk about disability, I like to turn that around and change it to a talk about ability. If you're in the disability services office here on campus, you have to know a lot about definitions of disability and reasonable accommodations and how to evaluate evaluations that have been done by experts about disabilities. But most of us are not in that situation. So for the rest of us, just looking at ability as a natural part of the human experiences, and that ability of all different dimensions, the ability is on a continuum for each one. So for instance, the ability to see. I started way off on the right-hand side as a child. I had very good sight for many, many years, and then I got up to a level where, well, I started having trouble reading, and so having to wear reading glasses and so forth. So slipping down to the left, that often happens over the life cycle. But the ability to hear is also on a continuum. So it's not a matter of this person is deaf or hard of hearing or not. It's everyone has a range. The ability to write with a pen or pencil, to communicate verbally, tune out distraction, learn, manage physical and mental health, all of those capabilities are in a continuum for everybody in this room. And so if we just think in those terms, we'll think more broadly about the abilities of people with disabilities. In this talk, I hope I'll do it perfectly, but I have no idea. Well, actually I do, but let's pretend I don't have any idea whether there's a person who's blind in this room. I don't need to know that. Why? Because I'm going to speak all the critical content of the images I've presented on the screen. So if you don't have to see the screen, in order to be inclusive and gain the content. What I do, I imagine in my mind that someone is actually accessing this event by phone. That's all you have to do, is just imagine somebody is just calling in and hearing the audio. What would you say differently? You probably wouldn't describe everything perfectly, like I wouldn't say what color that double-edged arrow is, but I need to say there's a double-edged arrow, there's a range that we're looking at here. So another thing to consider is intersectionality. People usually don't have just one identity. They're overlapping or intersecting social identities and related systems. And in those systems, there's oppression, domination, discrimination. There's a mix of privilege and penalty. That could be a whole day where you talk about this type of stuff that goes along with those identities. And it's important to embrace variability and uncertainty, that everyone comes with a variety of identities when they get engaged in a course or some activity. The typical approach is for dealing with disability in a program like this and elsewhere is to adjust the product or the environment for a particular person. That's called an accommodation. So that's how I'm using that word. We might provide extra time on a test or a quiet testing area or an alternative format. For instance, I mentioned already that the brochure that you have is available in an alternative format on the website. I did that intentionally. So I know that this publication, as I handed it to you, is not fully accessible to many people in its current form. Sign language interpreters, we don't have one here today. Why? Because an offer was made for an accommodation for a sign language interpreter, and no one requested one. So sign language interpreting is an example of maybe it's not reasonable to provide one a sign language interpreter in every class if you don't know if the person's going to need them. So we put that in the accommodation pile. So accommodation isn't wrong, but we rely on it too much. Instead, we should look at the products and the environments that we're creating and seeing how we can make them more accessible, more usable from the front end. So universal design, as defined by the Center on Universal Design at North Carolina State University, is the design of products and environments to be usable by all people to the greatest extent possible without the need for adaptation or specialized design. So that's the goal. How can we design things so we'll minimize the accommodations people might need? I love this quote from a Vietnamese Buddhist monk. When you plant lettuce, if it does not grow well, you don't blame the lettuce. You look for reasons it is not doing well. It may need fertilizer, more water, less sun. It's like that in a class. If you're teaching an online learning class, if a student is doing well, think about how we might redesign the class. It may be because the student's not studying and isn't doing the exercises. Well, you can't do anything about that, but maybe your design could be improved. Just to give you an example now of the process of universal design, I challenged my staff years ago to come up with a universally designed name tag that we could use at conferences, large events at conferences. And this is the one we came up with, zeroing into the solution. We found that in our little research, that the most commonly requested type of name tag at a conference is the lanyard. I personally don't like lanyards. The name tag is too low on my body. It's just like, I don't want people looking down there. So I'm not uncomfortable with that. Most people want lanyards. So if we're just looking at the average person or the one people want most, we'd have everything on lanyards. But it wouldn't meet my needs because I don't like lanyards. And so our universally designed name tag has a name tag on the lanyard. We provide lanyards. Why? Because that's what most people want. So we're not going to ignore the major population. But I want to have options. And so if you notice on my lanyard, the name tag is clipped. And so when I go to a conference, if I go to my own conference, because nobody else seems to do this, then I might want to have a clip if I have a lapel. But some days I wear a silk blouse. I don't want to, and it doesn't have a collar. I'm not clipping it on there. So maybe I'll use my lanyard that day. And there might be other times when I don't have anything to clip it to, so I'd really like to use a pin, maybe do a sweater. And so there's a pin, a safety pin that goes through that clip. And so I can go from day to day. Also, what is one of the most problematic things about lanyards when you go to a conference? What happens? They flip over. And so a very simple solution to that we do, and I've never seen another conference do it, you just put the name on both sides, and you make it very large for people who have visual impairments or just can't see it very well for other reasons. So the idea is that when you're designing something, you don't think average. You think of the broad range of people that might be using your product. So where might we apply this? Well, you can apply it to create inclusive physical environments, services, learning activities, and technology. And universal design then will provide inclusive access. And one quick example from our campus, these are actually two buildings on our campus, where on the left you see an ADA compliant entrance to a building, where we have a ramp and we have steps right next to each other, ADA compliant. But it's not inclusive. Universal design is inclusive. If I'm walking into that building with someone who's using a walker, we have to part ways, or I have to walk in front of them or behind them. On the right is a very sloping entrance. There's the main entrance, which is a very wide ramp. And so you get in there. That's the main entrance. The area where you can use stairs is there, but it's not the main entrance. So if you want to use stairs, you can. But the main entrance is inclusive of everyone. Beneficiaries of captions, for instance, a universal design feature, include people who are deaf and hard of hearing, but also people where English is not their first language, or they're in a noisy environment, or a noiseless environment, like a baby's bedroom. When they have a slow internet connection, or they want to know the spelling of words, or need to find content easily. Perfect example of universal design to caption videos. Another one is our smartphones. We have learned about the accessibility features built into our smartphones, changing the background from black to white and so forth, enlarging the characters. My phone talks to me. I hate that thing. I can't get it to shut up, but it does. And then ensuring the compatibility with assistive technology is important too, so that those devices can be connected, let's say, to a Braille printer if you want Braille printing. Teaching and learning, we provide students with multiple ways to gain the knowledge we're teaching, to demonstrate the knowledge, and to engage in the course. And so we want to proactively address these things. Cyber learning. We have a handout over here on 20 tips for making an accessible online course. And there are nine of the tips for websites, sites and documents and images and so forth, and 11 for instructional methods. Just a couple examples that you'll find on that list. Structuring your headings on websites so that people can scan through your document and their screen reader can read what the headings are. Using descriptive wording for hyperlinks. That's because a person who's blind, who's scanning through your web page using a screen reader, they want to see what it's linked to so they can scan from heading to heading with their screen reader. If you just say click here, on all of them it says to that person who's blind, it says click here, click here, click here. So they have to go back and read every single word of your website in order to access the content. Using text descriptions of content and images, again, for students using a screen reader. And large fonts, uncluttered pages, much like I'm using today, plain backgrounds, and captioning videos, which we've mentioned before. There are also teaching methods that they should employ. Creating your content in multiple ways, like a video and a publication, but also making sure each of those ways is accessible. Avoiding acronyms or spelling them out, describing them. Making the expectations clear, providing outlines and other what we call scaffolding tools. Options for communicating and collaborating that are accessible to people with a variety of disabilities, and options for people to demonstrate their learning in your class. So what universal design is, as I'm talking about it here, we'll hear more about it today, is it is first of all an attitude that you're just thinking inclusively. You're not saying things like, well, most people want. Next time you say that, most people want. Say, people want, what is the variety of things that they want? It values diversity, so we actually embrace diversity. I'm looking for faculty members to praise when they have praise when they're talking about a student who is enrolled in their class who might be blind. I haven't had this happen yet. Usually it's a problem. I've got a student who's blind. I don't know how I'm going to accommodate them. Rather than saying, I have a student who's blind in my art history class. You know, we're going to learn so much from this person. I've never thought about how you experience art history if you aren't able to see the images. Values diversity, equity, and inclusion, promotes best practices, does not lower standards, is proactive and can be implemented incrementally, benefits everybody, and also minimizes the need for accommodations. And it can inspire a framework for inclusive practices, so where you could apply it to everything. And in that framework, it's important to include the scope, like online learning was our example, the definition, I shared one, but you could, whatever you need, definition of universal design, also learn about the principles and the guidelines and practices, and then develop a process. And so in your workflow in online learning, you continually make sure that everything is inclusive.